had this extraordinary dream. Very extraordinary dream. I was in this very beautiful suburban area, and suddenly warplanes appeared, and they came and they bombed this area, bombed the heck out of it. And I was like, what in the world is going on here? So I actually went to look to see, you know, what the damage was, what had been damaged. And what they'd done is they'd taken out a concrete plant where all the materials to produce concrete were. Huge, huge concrete plant. I said, you know, wow. So I woke up. I started looking at it. And immediately I said, ah, this is extraordinary. I get it. That this depicted some sort of inner change within me that's taking place, where concretization, the generation of concretization, which is concrete plant, which generated concrete, that which generates concreteness, has been taken out, absolutely wiped out, non-function, non-operational now. So this is a very, very auspicious dream, that something like this. Our dreams are way wiser than we realize it, but we don't really understand the context that this is why we struggle with trying to interpret. But there's it's definitely telling us what's going on beneath the surface, oftentimes before it actually surfaces here. There may be something beneath the surface, and it's going up towards the surface, and we see it beneath the surface, and then several days later it surfaces, to use the term surfacing, which is, you know, it's tough to make words perfectly accurate, you know, here. So, but we don't worry about that. We understand the spirit of this inquiry. Very important to have the spirit of inquiry, the spirit of repentance. Realize repentance means to realize we have a very severe problem. We've been pretending to be what we're not, and we believe our pretending is our functionality and our creativity. It comes from this pretending, and if we stop pretending, we won't have any functionality, we won't have any creativity, we'll be nothing. So this is called the continuity fear. We're very terrified of this. But to repent is to recognize that we do have this problem, very severe problem, but this is the only problem we really have. And then we go to work on evaporating this problem and resolving it. This becomes a life work. Anything that is important enough to talk about should be done in a very serious, stable, dedicated manner, where you have to manage your success in looking at it, the wow of looking at it, and work on flipping the script to see how you can gain momentum out of this. So anything that's very, really important, worth talking about, it must be talked about in a context, a spiritual context, meaning momentum towards more and more and more and more clarity and success. The spiritual path is just the momentum towards greater and greater clarity. Ultimately towards setting down our pretense. Ultimately. So really, we're either on the spiritual path or we're not. And if we're not, we're really just aimless. So this is what I see in the world, that nobody talks about anything serious socially. I have no interaction with anybody socially, that because you can't just give it lip service and say, oh, you know, this, yeah, this, blah, 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 and that's it. You get no momentum there. You backslide a lot, and it's just very ineffective. So anything that's worth talking about is worth talking about in a very serious, dedicated manner, where you're willing to put in the time and then deal with the success and the repercussions and the backlash and manage your success and the wow. You have all of this is involved. Now, the Pope spoke to the United Nations today. I read a sort of synopsis of what he said, and it's more of the same. The problem is the Pope wants it both ways, but he's a humanist. Okay, this is what he is. He's a hardcore humanist, and he keeps repeating over and over and over and over and over, you know, the human person, the human life, human nature, distinct. You know, he says we're all human, we're all people, we're all. This is a humanist, and he has a special devotion to the Virgin Mary, which most religious humanists do. This is because why? It's a substitute for the Holy Spirit. Plain and simple. Humanists are not listening to the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, they wouldn't be humanists anymore. It's very Holy Spirit quickly leads us past humanism. So what they want is a projection of their own position, that I'm human, someone to defend this position. So they turn to the goddess they call the Virgin Mary, but it's just a goddess archetype. They just use the mother of Jesus because they think that God became flesh, which God did not, and therefore Mary must have had some. Must have been that which gave rise to the flesh of God, so she must be, you know, the mother of God or something. You know, it's you know, anyway, it's not true at all. None of that is true. Yet, but they to avoid the Holy Spirit, you need a something to replace it, because we're drawn towards the Holy Spirit. So they say, no, whatever problems I have, I'll go to the Virgin Mary. So the Pope. Has a great devotion to the Virgin Mary, the untier of knots. So whenever there's a knotty problem, he goes to the Virgin Mary, prays to the Virgin Mary, and this is what he encourages, you know, Catholics to bring all your knotty problems to the Virgin Mary. You know, the whole time the Pope's been in the United States, I don't know if he's ever uttered the term the Holy Spirit, unless it's in the Nicene Creed, and during Mass. I don't recall him in any of his speeches mentioning the Holy Spirit even one time, or even Jesus Christ, hardly at all, if ever, or salvation through grace. I don't recall him ever saying that. So this is a humanist, you know, plain and simple. He is an absolute humanist, but he's very sophisticated, with the Vatican is, their speechwriters. In that he acts as though he's the champion of people and you know, chastises corporation and greedy powerful countries. So he's a champion of the people, champion humanist kind of thing. But at the same time, he's fueling all those corporations by promoting humanism. He's producing the materialistic greed and vanity and all that, which feeds the corporations and the wealth and the materiality and capitalism, everything like that, which he stands up there and shakes his finger at, you know. I mean, it's complete hypocrisy. He thinks he can have his cake and eat it too. He thinks we can believe that we're humans and somehow be perfectly human and be happy. This is nonsense. It's what is driving all of this is the belief that we are human. All our troubles, all this is what's driving it all. So he's just reinforcing the problem, actually. And yet trying to appear that he's really standing up for the little person and standing up for our well-being. He's not. He's not standing up for our well-being. He doesn't have the guts to stand up in front of the UN and tell the truth to these leaders, that we're not human, that we're not people here. We're spirit pretending to be human, pretending to be people, spirit trying to change what it is, out of arrogance, trying to be greater than God. So we have this very terrible continuity problem. It's the only problem we have in this world. All this other stuff would instantly vanish if we solved the continuity problem. Instantly. We wouldn't have any problems whatsoever. We would realize, oh, this is just a dream. What kind of problems do you really have in a dream? You just wake up from the dream, and what happens to the problems? They're not there anymore. Then you realize they never really were there. Not really. So, but as long as you keep emphasizing we're human, we're people, we're human, then you're just putting them in a prison of all these problems. So, you know, it's just an extraordinary situation that's being laid bare for everybody to see. And certainly, the untier of knots is the Holy Spirit. This is what God created the Holy Spirit to be, the untier of knots, that's not of continuity fear. This Holy Spirit is absolute dedication from God, okay, within our minds, within our spirit. God didn't say, hey, I created the Virgin Mary to be the untier of our continuity problem. Where does that doctrine come from? This is an absurdity. And so it's 100% the humanistic substitution of, oh, I can't really listen to the Holy Spirit because it will tell me I'm not really a human. I don't want to hear that. So I'll listen to the goddess who says, oh, of course you're human, my child, my dear little child, my dear little human child person. Of course you are. And of course you have these naughty problems. I totally understand. I commiserate. I have so much compassion with you. And I'll help you, you know, work through these problems and resolve them and make you happy here. I'm your mother. You know, I'm the mother. I understand what it's like to be a mother giving birth to flesh, you know, and all this kind of nonsense. That this is a humanistic substitution for the Holy Spirit, plain and simple. They're not listening to what God sent to free us from our continuity fear. They're not listening at all. They've turned a blind ear, blind eye, deaf ear, shutting it out, shut out. I don't hear anything the Pope has said that is inspirational in terms of salvation at all. It's all 100% humanistic, feel-good stuff, which is what it is. It's humanistic feel-good stuff. It has nothing to do with our salvation. And yet this massive organization claims that it's these are God's people. That in itself is a contradiction. God doesn't have any people. God didn't create people. God created spirit, formless spirit, truth, spirit, eternal life. That's it. God's people, what does that mean? We're God's people. Everyone is God's spirit. Spirit created. There's no aspect of spirit that God did not create with perfect standing. So there's no such thing as anyone who is not doesn't have perfect standing with God. It's ridiculous when you hear some country or some institution or someone else saying, we're God's people, we're God's chosen people. That this means they don't know God at all. They really think that the ego, continuity fear, the vice of continuity fear, they really think that is God. That's what humanists actually believe. They don't know God. Otherwise, they'd not be talking the way they talk. And they don't realize they're just making their situation worse, making the continuity fear worse. So they think that their tradition is a really true tradition, spiritual tradition, and then this other is some kind of, maybe it's some kind of super high tradition at best, I think, but it's not really approachable and they don't understand. No, it's not that way at all. It's humanist listening to the continuity fear and thinking that this right is no tradition at all. There's no momentum there at all, actually. All this human quote-unquote human activity, effort, all this, there's no real momentum, escape velocity taking place there at all. So there's no spiritual tradition there, actually, that they're referencing. And whatever successes history has had throughout history, those who have escaped from the continuity fear or resolved it, reasonably resolved it, they just kind of fluff it over and say, well, yeah, they were really great humanists is what they really were. It wasn't reported accurately. They think Jesus was a great humanist. If they even reference Jesus at all, I don't hear the Pope referencing Jesus at all, really. They you know, perfunctory stuff, but his talks are devoid of you know, saying care for the person, care for the poor, care for the disadvantaged. This is our goal in life. This is what we must do. You know, well, how do you care for the poor? Didn't Jesus come to help the poor in spirit? Well, aren't we all poor in spirit? Because we listen, we believe the continuity fear is God. It's very poor in spirit. So Jesus came to help the poor in spirit. Also recognizing pragmatically issues of compassion, etc. But first, put the priority first. You know, the Pope's not even mentioning it, the real priority at all. And so he's playing a very clever game of pretending to chastise the United Nations, you know, or at the same time is doing more than anyone to feed it, to promote it, to push humanism to the front. And of course, the Catholic Church's real mission should be to insist, push salvation to the front. That's his great mission and great work, is push the message, the gospel, the good news of salvation that Jesus brought to the front, to the fore, and highlight that over humanism. Not both, but over human. Make it clear that this is our real responsibility. And shame them for ignoring it. There's a function of shaming that's very important, admonishing and shaming, saying, hey, you're not seeing what your priorities really are. So they should tell the world, hey, you don't see your priorities correctly. Here's your true priority. This is what should be done, and it's being completely neglected. Not surprising, because the church age is actually over. So it's not surprising that this is taking place at all. That this pope is actually pope of nothing, because the church age is over. It's finished. Jesus has already returned, and so we're now turning to the Holy Spirit to get the clarity on Jesus and what's expected of us and how we can align with that. Now, back to that dream of the concretization is very important. The whole operation of concretizing was taken out in this dream by bombers. Bombed into rubble. Just rubble. Left it in rubble and ruins. The concretization. So somehow that strike was authorized within my being. So hopefully this will be revealed. It will the fullness of this will be present somehow, right? This is the hope now. Today is the 25th. We're going now to for Saturday 26th, Sunday the 27th, and then Monday the 28th is the fourth of the tetrad of four blood moons, a series of four blood moons in a row. And this is said to be a very, 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 very significant time. And this is a very significant time, because there's this massive push now to put humanism ahead of everything. And what the Pope is doing is it's trying to say that there's some option within humanism that's preferable to another option within humanism. It's making people think that the choice is between what style of humanism do you want. See, this is what the Pope is doing. It's a very basic egoic diversion tactic, which is to say that you can either have humanism this way or that way, and that's the real decision. That's the important decision. Not decide between humanism and salvation, but decide between what brand of humanism do you want. And so it diverts. We feel like there's a really important choice we have to make, right? This is what we feel. What path, or a fork in the road, which way do we go? And then the Pope said, I see the fork. Here's a fork in the road. We either go to this style of humanism or to this style of humanism. And I think then this one's better. And then people say, oh, thank you, Pope. You're giving us such great advice. Whereas actually, this is the ego tricking ourselves, thinking we've made some profound spiritual choice to go down this style of humanism, whereas in fact we're just cleverly delaying, not even looking at listening to the Holy Spirit at all. We say we don't need to. We already made the right choice. We got the right humanism. We know we made the right choice. So why do we need to listen to the Holy Spirit for? Well, the Holy Spirit will tell us we're not human. We're spirit. We're pretending to be something in time, space, process, form. Some definition. We're not any definition. We cannot be defined. So we have we've beaten the Pope and the POTUS and the UN and Congress and everybody to the punch, and then you hear this morning that the Speaker of the House has just resigned. I didn't go looking for this. I happened to go into a room where the TV was on. Someone said, "Oh, did you hear the news?" Da, 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 da. It's like, wow. Maybe that's why he was crying while the Pope was speaking yesterday, day before yesterday, the 24th. I said, "Oh my gosh, this is my last day as Speaker of the House." So this stirs the political pot very severely now. And polarization, I mean, just like I said, September, this September is very, very profound as a tipping point. And so we get now, what the Pope has tried to do is enfold everybody, then the president too, enfold everybody into humanism by saying, "Hey, everybody, I have a better view of humanism than the UN or Congress or the president." And so those who want to go along with the president or Congress or the UN, they say, "Well, we're going to stick with our humanism." And others say, "Well, I'm going to go with the Pope's humanism." And so everybody gets caught up in the web of humanism this way, just about everybody, thinking that they have options here, but it's really the exact same option. The belief in pretense, sticking, we're going to stick with pretense is what it really is saying. We're going to stick with pretense, but just we're going to pretend this way instead of this way. We're going to pretend to put the little people ahead of the big people, other, you know, which is in doing that you just feed the neuroses, as it were. Yeah. Says you are people, you just have to more fully identify as people, and you have important human rights, and you have people rights, and you need to assert those, and you need to have good housing and food and everything, and be a happy person, and this is what you are entitled to. This is what God gives you. You know, this is ludicrous. What God gives us is perfect eternal life, right here, right now. We have it right now. So it's a basic snare that's going on, and those who can see through it, it's not difficult to see through it, but if you're blind to it, then it seems very, very profound. So here we are, Friday evening, and the Pope will be headed off to maybe to Philadelphia, perhaps tomorrow, for some concluding appeal to humanism, a more compassionate humanism, is what he's really saying. Let us have a more compassionate humanism. And so the whole dialogue is about humanism. Which form of humanism? It shuts out the dialogue of the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit wants to have a true dialogue too, a true inquiry, a true listening. But no, you know, people, we work, keep working to shut it out. Absolutely shut it out. Amazing, bombing that concrete factory. It means no more concrete will be going out anywhere. No more concretization. No more concretization is what it means. So, well, I say, you know, there have been some major milestones. Something did show up in the world. For instance, A Course in Miracles, it actually showed up in the world. Thank you, Jesus, for doing that, getting that done. It wasn't just empty promise, it actually happened. I was aware of the promise ahead of time, but then to see it actually occurred was really spectacular. And this is what we're looking for. We're looking for something that actually, there's actual occurrence here. And from time to time, you know, we're up for that, right? We may not want it every day, it might be too much, but from time to time, we feel ready to, you know what, I really want something profound. I want something to actually happen, you know, really profound here. Not just in dreams or speculation, but I want it to actually show up. Occasionally we're in the mood for that, and now is the time for that, because the humanism is off to the races now. Off to the races. The Pope has framed the future in such a way that humanism is absolutely feels unfettered right now. Unfettered, because he failed to deliver the gospel entirely here. He ignored the gospel. He ignored the gospel of Jesus and just came with his social justice message. That's it. He's a dyed-in-the-wool, secular humanist, religious humanist, you might call them. And so we feel, oh, we have a choice to be either be a secular humanist or a religious humanist. How fortunate we are. Which one is better? You know, thinking there's some difference. There's no difference there. Fundamentally, there's not any difference at all there. So he turns to Mary, the entire of knots, Virgin Mary, entire of knots. Poor Virgin Mary, or Mary. All the stuff that's been laid on her, you know, she just said, well, I had a child, and child turned out to realize that he wasn't really a human at all, or body at all, it was a spirit, I wasn't responsible for that. He had the clarity, you know, to recognize this, and it wasn't me. I didn't bring that about. Jesus never said that Mary is the key to his wisdom or anything like that. It's the Holy Spirit. It's listening to the Holy Spirit within. And of course, Jesus knew, was already liberated prior to animating a body, animating an appearance. We call it body appearance here. And a savior like that does not identify with the body, actually. Does not identify with it. So say Mary gave birth to a body. Well, body is just nothing. It's neutral. It's just a neutral rag, empty shell, really. A rag doll is. So I would bet that Mary's aware of this. Say, what are these people trying to make all these idols out of me? You know, they came from Egypt, Isis. They just continue that on, and from every ancient culture, always seems to have a goddess they worship, and it's no different now. The undoer of all knots. You know, no. It's the Holy Spirit that gets us past the continuity fear. I don't know anyone who's truly liberated, say the Virgin Mary is the reason why she's the one that liberated me. I'm not aware of that. So it's just the belief in flesh, wanting to keep the belief in flesh, okay? And the Holy Spirit not having any appearance or form, or, you know, it makes those who want to believe in flesh uncomfortable. They say, wow, I need a body, you know, a human flesh. I want someone like me, like what I am. Holy Spirit seems formless and all-knowing, and it says, I'm just a little flesh-based human with very limited perspective. But again, this is just a complete pretending by Spirit. Nothing but pretending. And we think, well, the Holy Spirit will lead me too quickly. No, the Holy Spirit, no. What is the Holy Spirit expert at? Continuity fear. So what is it extremely aware of? Continuity fear. So it's hardly going to lead us too fast. I mean, that would cause delay. Holy Spirit, his whole purpose is to minimize delay to our awakening, minimize delay to us ending our pretense. So of course it understands backlash and is aware that if it tries to go too fast, this will actually slow things down. So the Holy Spirit guides our path in such a way that it maximizes our speed and minimizes our delay. But it can often seem like it slows down on purpose. So why are we slowing down? And then we realize, wow, I was going so fast. I was likely to suddenly turn to some flesh-based reassurance, which really then the wheels come off very badly. So we have a Virgin Mary worshiping religious humanist. Telling the world this is the way the world should go. This is our future. Along with the UN being more of a secular humanist, saying this is the future. And they don't really disagree. I don't really disagree. The Pope just wants to say, hey, we want some say, you know, make sure you're not going to forget about us, you know. We're going to have an important role in the new world agenda. So they want to seem to stand for something, you know, it's like, hey, well, you can't leave this perspective out, this humanistic perspective out of the, and so they're jockeying for, you know, power in the new world agenda. The president, the UN, the Pope, they're all jockeying for power is what they're doing. So the loss of all concreteness. Well, I didn't seem too dismayed. Somebody said they wanted to buy a classical guitar. They wanted to play classical guitar along with something. I don't know what it was. And they said, well, I need like $500,000 or something like that, $250,000, some enormous sum. They asked me if I could find a guitar that was worth that much for them. And I said, wow, I don't think so. I can't figure that one out. I guess classical guitar would symbolize the old approach that doesn't work, you know, humanistic approach. But they want it to be really expensive, so it seems, you know, important. And I said, I don't think I can really find that for you. Keep in mind that, again, anything worth talking about is worth doing right and talking about it the right way, which means giving it ample time, effort, attention, managing your success, managing the wow. Everything we talk about here is actually very intense and profound, and it does have an effect. Just hearing that it's possible to have your concretization wiped out within us. That's astonishing. And we keep the memory of concretization alive with the neither nor practice. Neither nor is a very important practice. To speak this way, to write this way, to think this way, the neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, keep that going. It's so crucial. I'm neither free nor not free. So all of our creative expressiveness that we've used in defending us, you know, our continuity fear, defending us from dropping our pretense, all that creativity, we're now blessing that, letting that be blessed, all of it. Finally. And yet, the concretization was part of that, part of that. So We will keep the concretization in the form of I'm neither concretized nor not concretized. I neither see concretization nor do I not see it. I neither experience concretization nor do I not experience it. What are you saying? Zero, basically. You're saying zero, but we're saying it in a format that at least pays honor to the fact that we use creativity, you know, towards believing in concretization. So we say, yeah, I'm neither experiencing concretization nor am I not experiencing concretization. And this is what enables us to actually abide in the freedom from it. And by extending the blessings to all of our creative expressions of suffering and misery that we thought were somehow persecuting us, but in fact were protecting us from our continuity fear, protecting us from ending our pretense. That's all that they've been doing. All of our suffering is nothing more than defensiveness designed to keep us from ending our pretense. That's it. And we desperately wanted that to happen, wanted us to not you know, to keep our pretense, thinking that we would be annihilated if we don't. So we have backed all this suffering 100%. But of course, we don't like it either. We can't help but not like it. But it's not like there's some external force persecuting us. Not at all. Not at all. So it's great good news to go that you can go to any aspect of your suffering and address it and relate to it and thank it. Thank you for your great efforts and great creativity. And I totally honor all your great creativity. And now, you know, I'm both moving on and not moving on. Let's both move on and not move on. And then that suffering, that form of suffering, you know, is part of, will be part of your salvation. Of they will feel that it's okay for them to feel elation, to feel blessed then. They don't have to feel sick. They can feel blessed. They don't have to be creatively expressing sickness, infirmity. They can now be creatively expressing feeling blessed. And so you give permission to all aspects of your of misery and suffering and delay to be blessed right now. And right now is so crucial. Right now meaning there's no delay in this blessing. If there was a delay in the blessing, you'd have to say, well, why? What did I do wrong to have to wait, you know, to have this blessing withheld? If we withhold it from you for even a second, we will search for the reason. Why was it withheld? Did someone do something wrong? So one of these aspects did something wrong? No. So it's right now. See, it's right now. It's right now. We have to emphasize this over and over and over again. Right now. That the blessing is right now. There's no waiting for it. None of these creative expressions of suffering need to wait for it one instant. It's absolutely right now. No delay or withholding whatsoever. Fullness right now. The fullness of expression is right now. Right now, right now, right now, right now, right now. And to honor our creativity of not now, we say it was both now and not now. Or it's neither now nor not now. Neither now nor not now. Neither now nor not now. Both now, not now. Both now and not now. Neither now, not now. It's neither now. Hey, it's neither now nor not now time. It's neither now nor not now time. And are all these expressions don't need to do anything, meaning they can just stay absolutely quiet. So this absolute quietness and peace, I'm certainly expecting what I'll be experiencing as all aspects of creative suffering, they all just go quiet together, just like that, all together. No one's trying to dominate and use the silence to promote, you know, themselves that way. They all go silent. And then I'll just say, wow, just experience the silence. And there's no indication they need to do anything other than to stay silent. So our mind can go silent. I'm expecting the mind just to go silent. In terms of this continuity issue and pretending, just go silent. I'm not saying they've stopped pretending. They neither stopped nor not stopped pretending. Or they both stopped and not stopped pretending. My pretense has both stopped and not stopped. So the silence would be something actually happening here. This is what I'm looking for. This will be really, it's time for actual situations, you know, to actual boosts to be here. Now, within our psyche, the reason why that doesn't happen is we're promoting some aspects of our creative suffering over others. Say, well, this is better than this, we're judging this, all this judging. Whereas I'm saying, no, they're all equally blessed, all equally honored. No choosing among any of them. They all did a great job, and they all can be silent and be elated. Every single one of them, I give them permission to be absolutely elated. Every single one of them. No exceptions. Not even thinking about any exception at all. So there's no need for all these thought processes of judgment taking place. There's a lot of shaking in my frame right now, the shoulders and everything, trembling. So it's very intense when you feel like that, you know, you're on the verge of the mind going silence in terms of the false mind going silent. So then we become aware of the true mind, which we cannot define as either silent or not silent. It's both silent and not silent. So the next few days should be really, really interesting. Really, 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 really interesting and important. I saw a table similar to the one I saw in the dream take refuge under by the side of the road. Free, you know, free. So free refuge, you know, wow, how's that going to go? Free sidestepping. Uh, And it's not like, you know, that we're supposed to listen to the Virgin Mary and the Holy Spirit. This is what the Virgin Mary tells us, that this archetype says, I'm co-redeemer. I work with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, and I supplement what they're doing. I have a role to play, and this role is equal to their role. And I, you know, they do part of it, and I do the other part of it. Well, this is not true. The Holy Spirit does all of it. The Holy Spirit does all of it. It's not like the Holy Spirit's incomplete and was only given half of a job and Virgin Mary got the other half. This is absolutely utter nonsense. The Holy Spirit got the whole job entirely. Every last bit of it. And it is absolutely perfectly capable to do every last bit of it. And that's what it does. We just think that we have to blend, you know, humanism with salvation, and so we think, well, of course I gotta have some humanist advising me too, otherwise we won't pay enough attention, you know, that pay enough attention to that. Well, now the Holy Spirit, believe it or not, the Holy Spirit, its way of seeing everything is the way, and its ways are not understandable to the humanistic perspective. So we actually get, you know, much more help by listening to the Holy Spirit in terms of our situation, our parent situation here. We get much greater help than if we try to listen to the goddess, who is just a product of our own continuity, fear, advice. It is not a creation by God like the Holy Spirit. It's just our own continuity, fear, advice, in a attractive, marketable form to us. To us, we say, oh, I wouldn't buy that if someone else was selling it, but well, she's selling it, oh, of course I'll buy it. This is what we do. So these are very heavy statements for most people. I know at some point it would have been very heavy for me too to hear this. Absolutely. Because we think the Holy Spirit's dangerous. Well, what's it going to do? You know, it's take us all the way. Oh, no, I don't want to stop pretending. Oh, my gosh. But we don't realize that there's an intermediate step, so to speak. That too is entirely the Holy Spirit's doing. Where we keep the form, but the content is now empty. The concretization is emptied out. It's neither this nor that, neither this nor that. So this information, you know, shakes us up because we're, it you know, it reveals our defenses, and we can see them clearly and say, oh my gosh. This is what I've been doing, and it doesn't work like that. But on the other hand, we're up for the adventure, being so adventurous. This adventure of gently setting down pretense ultimately is a great adventure for us. So, you know, we don't want to miss it. We want to do this. They say the snake has a forked tongue. That's like, you know, humanism saying, hey, I got two options. That's the snake. That's the clever deceiver. And choose, here's where the real choice, meaningful choice is between these two options, where in fact it's not a meaningful choice at all. It's a useless choice, meaningless choice. And the snake is always using that forked tongue to check options, check this option, check that option, check this option. And so we are always thinking that, you know, thinking that we're doing progress and being smart by evaluating these two options and trying to figure out, we don't quite realize it's just a trick, it's a self-deception, that those aren't really an option at all. They're two sides of one coin. And the real option is repentance. That's the real option. The Pope, I don't think, spoke much about repentance at all. There was no emphasizing that. If you want to help the little person, then tell them that they need to repent. Just the same way you want to help the big person, tell them that, you know, tell them they need to repent. And push and support that agenda. UPS guy. He gets it. Walked past me, didn't notice me on the way out. I with a wave, and he just gave a little nod to me, quiet nod, you know. He's in the zone. Sometimes the UPS drivers are in the zone. You know, there could be those on the path of repentance could be, you know, be driving a UPS truck. Absolutely. That could be a very profound meditation. Going into all these houses quietly and then leaving them, you know, getting used to doing that helps non-attachment, you know, to this. It can be very profound. Some say taxi drivers, any profession actually, can be actually a deep meditation. Oftentimes, lowly jobs, you might find the ones who are most farthest along on the path, in lowly positions in this world, anonymously, evaporating their continuity fear, overcoming, you know, their attachment to pretense. You don't know what they look like. They're not all dressed up in orange robes saying, look at me, look at me, look at me, I'm very spiritual. Not necessarily. So the path of the Holy Spirit is going on for everybody all the time. It's completely attentive to everyone simultaneously, always. So from the Holy Spirit standpoint, there's only the path. Now, it understands there are those who are just going, you know, extremely slow or back and forth. Except, but from the standpoint of the Holy Spirit, it sees it as a path, opportunity. The Holy Spirit always is there, vigilant to take any willingness we have and to use that as leverage to gain more willingness. Well, there you had someone who came up along the path. Give a little nod, just a nod, just a little nod. Okay. Interesting. See, there's no activist agenda there with the UPS driver, whereas the other situation was someone with who wanted to convince and support their activism. One of these young women that the Pope speaks about so frequently in the UN so frequently, that they're our future because they're our future activists. They're the ones who have infinite capacity for activism. And so I say, I can't entertain you now. They were shocked, like, oh, but the UPS guy, you know, he gets it. I'm not here to, you know, for any activism. I'm just delivering something, just deliverance. There's no activism, actually. So smooth, it's smooth. Those who are enlightened are not humanist activists. They're not activists in humanism at all. They're not here to get your, you know, signature on a petition. Not at all. They don't have all these causes that they're, you know, promoting. The only one cause, repentance, that's it. Repentance is the path. Repentance is again saying, I know, I've accepted, I have a very severe problem. That's it. But who in this world wants to accept they have a very severe problem? Isn't this what we fight against more than anything? I know people right now who are in all sorts of trouble. And yet, they've not repented a single bit. They say, no, 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 no. I can handle all this. I can handle it. I can handle it. I can handle it. I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem. Meanwhile, all these things are happening. You're pointing out, hey, you know, you've got severe issues and problems, et cetera, et cetera. No. Because that'll take the fun out of the enjoyment out of life. I mean, if you realize you have a very severe problem, then you're going to have to work on that problem, right? So life becomes merely a working on that problem. Where's the fun in that? So these people are desperately trying to have fun, until their daddy takes the T-bird away, until they die. But yeah, have fun until I die. They avoid the effort and the basic responsibility of repentance. Now, have I ever had any fun in my life? No. But that is that some big regret? No. I've had the intensity of the spiritual path, which is way better than fun. It makes fun look like it's just some shallow, cheap mask. So am I thinking, how can I have fun this weekend? No, I'm thinking, how can I, you know, evaporate more continuity fear this weekend? How can I get down into even greater intensity? How can I get, you know, how can we let that, the non-concretization, a realization of non-concretization, let that be present? So the focus is always on, you know, the path and more momentum and more success and managing success. It's you know, my mind is never on fun, really. It's never on to fun, how to have fun. So we're still in this very intense week, we're still in this very intense month, and we're expecting huge payoff for our diligence here. No question about it. So when the silence arrives, I'll just say, well, that's because all this is just an honoring of all these expressions of suffering I've been using. They're now finally being able to feel bliss and elation. So I'm honoring my creativity in that way. And so they're just quiet. So this is just good. Okay, so they've all gone quiet. And now they're experiencing the bliss. Okay, wonderful. This is how I would look at it. So I don't put it in a framework of enlightenment or something. I try to make it more pragmatic than that. Get a richer context of it, clearer context of it. So I can say, I'm neither enlightened or not enlightened. If someone says, are you enlightened? Well, I'm neither enlightened or not enlightened. Meaning I wouldn't call it enlightenment. But I'm honoring your creativity. And your expression, creative expression, but I wouldn't call it enlightenment. I wouldn't call it both enlightenment, not enlightenment, neither enlightenment nor not enlightenment, neither peace of mind nor not peace of mind, because you don't want what spirit continuity fear is trying to do is pin us down into some definition that distracts us from the pragmatic context, because once we start glimpsing the pragmatic context of it, then we're really, really, really can make great progress. It takes the fear out of it. Enlightenment's some huge abstract word, like you think you're just thrown into some abyss, you know. I say, no, I'm not, that's not the situation at all. All the inhabitants of the realm of long faces, of just suffering, misery, and all its disguises, all its forms, are now all experiencing elation, that they're being honored and being blessed. All at the same time. This is what's really happening. This is the way I would see it. This is what's happening. And so in the mirror of my mind, that's what's being reflected. So the world would see that reflection and say, oh, you must be enlightened or something. I said, well, yeah, I'm neither enlightened nor not enlightened. And this would clue them into, maybe there's a better way of looking at it than using these buzzwords like enlightenment or self-realization or, you know, things like that. Those actually, you know, those are mostly buzzwords, and you need a much, you know, much clearer context of what's going on, so you can abide in it. That's why some teachers refuse to say what they are. Anonymous, I wouldn't say what she was. It's just, I'm neither enlightened or not enlightened. I'm not saying I'm any teacher or guru at all. Because as soon as you say you're a teacher, a guru, enlightened, they immediately they try to pin you, put you into some role, some context that the continuity fear has arranged. So, yeah, I'm both. This is both peace of mind and not peace of mind. Or you can say, well, this is peace of mind. But even that, you know, it tries to avoid the context, avoid the pragmatic, what's really going on. Because in seeing that, this is what really elevates us quickly towards success. Whereas if we just stay in sort of these vague terms, oh, I'm enlightened, I'm going towards self-realization. What, you know, what the heck does that mean? In pragmatic terms, what is the context of that? You know, it's nothing. It's just, you know, even it's an amorphous term. I don't know what to say. There's nothing to say about it, really. But if you realize what the problem has been, that we've just been pretending, all these forms of pretense, with massive creativity, and the key is to make this deal with all these forms of pretense, saying, I'm not, let's drop the suffering from all this. Let's empty all these forms out. Empty, let them be empty, and yet let's honor the creativity that was used to animate all these expressions of suffering and pretense. So let there be a blessing upon all of these empty forms. Let there be a blessing. Let the emptiness be filled up with just this blessing, this peaceful blessing, not judgmental, peaceful blessing. And they agree with this. They say, oh, this is great. Thank you. I've been waiting for this for so long. This is what's really happening. And thanks to Jesus for explaining the basics of all this, instead of just saying, hey, you need to be enlightened, you know. You know, he got down, and the mechanic got down and showed us, you know, there's really something to this of self-forgiveness. This is what we really need to do. So you can just say, I'm experiencing self-forgiveness. I'm both experiencing it and not experiencing it in terms of definition, because it goes beyond any definition. But I'll make sure we're not trapped in any definition, including positive ones. I feel like a telephone call is going to come at some point here. But we'll keep going on. Let me get the phone. Where is it? Okay. And keep in mind that the time you give it to this, it's not like it has to be perfect. Everything has to be perfect. That's another trick of the continuity fear, or you can't practice yet, or you can't do this because circumstances aren't perfect for you. You got to wait until they're perfect, and then you'll have a media breakthrough. And it is nonsense. Then you wait your whole life in vain. You know, we got the UPS guy came up, maybe get a phone call, interruption here, you know, drink of water there. But you keep your resolve. Your resolve, just understand this, that the fly might be buzzing around. But we, you know, we can certainly evaporate a lot of continuity fear by doing this, and this is what actually succeeds ultimately. It's not some radical breakthrough that we're trying to suddenly push through. The breakthrough comes of its own accord when the continuity fear has been lessened, and like in that dream, the concretization was just wiped out, gone, reduced to rubble. No more concretization. And I was just like, holy cow. You know, it's like someone called in this airstrike. It must have been spirit. The Holy Spirit called in this airstrike against, you know, on concretization. Which will be great. I'm looking forward to it. I don't know how it will feel, but that's the whole, you know, the encountering success is what it's all about. We have to prepare ourselves to encounter success. Our relationship with success. A Course in Miracles. I've had a relationship with the Course in Miracles. It's success. Very strong success. So we have to be willing to have a relationship with success. Inner success. Inner success. Our own inner success. Our own inner recognition. Our own inner clarity, our own inner clarity, your own inner clarity. You have to be willing to have a relationship with that. Gorgeous day. Wow. Just another unbelievably great day. It's ridiculous. Hardly a breath of air, you know, moving about, and gorgeous sort of thin clouds, every streaked everywhere, and the sun getting a little bit of diffusion, and the warmth. This is really quite an extraordinary place, weather-wise, California. It's almost like you have to pinch yourself, really. How is this possible? But of course, continuity fear tries to make you think, well, that's all you need, just some good weather. No, we gotta go beyond that. We appreciate it, thank you for it, but we have to go beyond that to peace of mind. So encounter with success is what we're looking forward to now. A true encounter with success. And, you know, we're ready for it. So the end of this concrete factory means no more concretization will be given out to everywhere, you know. None of the trucks will be hauling all this concrete and pouring all this concrete everywhere. And all the concretization that we get rid of, it won't be replaced. They will not be able to replace it. You know, we just take this concrete factory as just, this is the way things are. It's always been there. This, and it just keeps on paving everything with concrete, keep concretizing everything. Well, now, it's no more. It's gone. Maybe we should plant a park there, clear the rubble out and plant a park. Now, I don't know exactly what this means, but obviously the Holy Spirit does. Obviously there's something within me that's very aware, you know, that this is what has to take place. So we'll just let it happen. So we're staying in touch with the key elements of the path here, in spite of all the news and all the big timing that's going on, right? All the humanism that's being promoted to an extraordinary extent. All the false options, the idea of a false option, two sides of one coin, you think you're getting a different coin. If you're looking at one side, you think I have a different coin than if I look at the other side, where it's actually the same coin. Okay, so we'll see what I can do to push this all forward very quickly. I would say I accept the freedom from concretization. I can be free of concretization. I will be free of concretization. I am already free of concretization. I'm free of concretization. I'm free of concretizing. I'm absolutely free of it. Say that, this practice this way. I can, I will, I'm already free. Very powerful practice. I can be free of concretizing. I will be free of concretizing. I am free of concretizing. And let yourself feel the fait accompli of this, that you feel you truly are. You're free of it. It just may have not surfaced yet. It's not, maybe not be playing out on the so-called surface here. But it's within, it's already been accepted. So I can be free of concretizing. I will be free of concretizing. I am free of concretizing. I already am. So at this point, we just adjust to what we feel has already happened, something we need to now adjust to. This is something that's already been decided upon. This is a great way to practice. I can, I will, I already am. I can be free of concretizing. I will be free of concretizing. I already am free of concretizing. I can, I will, I am. I can be free of concretizing. I will be free of concretizing. I am already free of all concretizing. I am indeed free. I am free of concretizing. And don't worry again, try to define it. Our spirit knows what this refers to. I can, I will, I am. I can, I will, I am. I can, I will. I am free of concretizing. As of right now, I am free of concretizing. As of right now, I'm already free of concretizing. Right now, I'm already free of all concretizing. As of right now, I'm already free of all concretizing. I'm already permanently free of all concretizing. As of right now, I'm already permanently free of all concretizing. Great. I expected somebody was coming down the path, but they weren't. It was actually a squirrel making sounds like it was like a wheels rolling. It was I don't advertise, you know, what I'm doing here. I don't advertise it. No, because people will try to block it for sure. Their continuity fear will try to make a deal, saying, whoa, that's too extreme. Okay, we admit we're too extreme, you're too extreme. Okay, let's make a compromise. And of course, this doesn't work. You either have peace of mind or you don't. You're either judging or you're not judging. You're either pretending or not pretending. You either made a deal with the continuity fear, the one deal we can make, or we haven't. We're either released as a hostage or not. You know, there isn't this compromise that the continuity fear tells us. one deal to honor our creativity. That's just the one deal there is. But other than that, nothing else is going to work. So, well, it's definitely the continuity fear. It feels threatened by a situation that is working to get free of it. And it says, whoa, not so fast, slow down, this is way too fast, you know, what are you doing, come on, stop, like that. So, it's not good necessarily to, you know, advertise to in your life, in your social situation, that you're, you know, diligently working to evaporate the continuity fear. People will not support that. Those who believe they're people, they're not going to support you saying that we're not people. What you're really saying to them is we need to stop pretending, and they say, "Well, I'll be annihilated." So of course they're going to try to, you know, hit the brakes. They'll find some way to trip you up, for sure. That's why most paths are anonymous paths. Nobody even realizes until someone is actually, you know, the mind is, the peace of mind is present. So don't try to explain to anybody. I've tried, it never works. They just get frightened. That's all that happens. You just frighten them. They get very frightened. So it's best just to, you gotta play the fool until peace of mind is here, until concretization is gone. So a lot of us think, well, I'll never meet up with success. Well, occasionally we do. It's not like we never do. It just seems to be far and few between. But there are instances where you do come across, like I remember coming across A Course in Miracles. I knew right then this was going to change my life for the better. No question about it. This was like very, very key. And so I was just like, wow, over the moon. Said, this is it. Here we go. So it does happen. It does happen here. You do sometimes meet up with great teachers and great teachings and great situations and great opportunities and inspirations and boosts. Those, that does occur occasionally. We'd like to have occur more often, but I guess we're not, you know, ready for it. When we're ready, it's supposed to then occur. This is what we're taught. I said, wow, you know, it's a lot of work getting ready. Certainly is. So with the ending of this concretization, I'll just have to experience it. What's the experience going to be? That's meeting up with success. I just have to get used to it, really. At that point, there's really nothing more to do. There's no way to concretize the experience, you see. The end of concretization, that you cannot concretize that experience. So it's inexpressible. You cannot really define it, you cannot concretize it. It's the non-concretized state. It's both the non-concretized state and not the non-concretized state, because it's not really a state either, is it? So I say it's both abidance and not abidance. The non-concretization, you might say, is both and neither. Both and neither, both and neither, both and neither. It's very important to have these lapses where we're not talking. This helps move us toward, non-concretization. Allow the wow, just allow it to sink in without trying to immediately think or judge or comment or anything. It's just like, wow, this is very heavy. And just accept the heaviness. I just accept it. I'm not going to, fill in with definition and concretization all the time. And then those who think they're people will want to reaffirm that by concretization. They'll say, "Well, explain it." You can't explain. I mean, what, give me, some concreteness here. And say, "Well, it's the absence of concreteness." They say, "Oh my gosh! I mean, that means the absence of a person, absence of a place, absence of, how can I? I won't exist there. I won't exist. Well, no, it still exists." So I'm looking forward to that. It's time. It's time for success here in September. No question about it. Holy Spirit is going to roll out, I believe. I hope and believe that it will roll out its charter, for the next 15 years or less here. And, in some way we're going to get an idea like, oh, okay, this is the kind of success that we're going to be relating to, in the future now. So this is the kind of success that we're going to be relating to in the future. And we can say, okay, great. This is an option to humanism. We need an option to humanism here, for sure. I don't know where that place might be in this world or how it could happen. That's the Holy Spirit's job. Or if it's even here in this world, I don't know. Because there's such a huge push now to get everyone, every single one of us, nobody left behind, into, you know, the artificial intelligence, technology, dictatorship, bureaucracy. Meet these goals, meet these targets. We're measuring your every breath, you know, and it's to save Mother Earth. We want to save Mother Earth. Stop believing that there is a Mother Earth. What a terrible thing, you know, to say that there's a world. Just let the world be saved from the world. It's just our creativity being used as a defense. And the world doesn't want to remain some world. It's not even a world in the first place. The world, you might say, the world's tired of being a world. Both is and isn't tired. Both is and isn't a world. So practice non-concretization as much as possible, which is what we do here. Neither nor. It both is, isn't. Neither nor. Both is and both is and is not. It both is and is not. It's neither this nor that. Practice, 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 practice. Get used to it, used to it, used to it, until it's like, you know, it's your first nature. You feel this is how I'm, this is what I'm comfortable with. Wow, it's getting hazy. It's nice. Those probably chemtrails. Actually, the sky is streaked with all this. It's probably a lot to do with the vapor trails that last all day, you know, the planes. I mean, when we were younger, that never happened. Actually, it didn't happen. You saw these, you know, jets and these little trail behind them, and then puff, be gone in 25 seconds. Nowadays, these clouds last all day. It's quite odd. It's not natural. It's not natural for artificial clouds like that to just last all day. Some say that, I mean, everyone blames the automobile, but really, it's well, you could say it's connected to it. The roads, all the pavement, everything that you know, soaks up and absorbs heat and radiates heat. It can get very hot in like cities. All the concrete, all of that stuff. And interesting, that dream I had, the city didn't have any, like, streets. Like, that was all just dirt. That's one thing I remember about it. There was no road. There were no roads, no sidewalks. And yet there were pathways that we went along like it was a road. No driveways. And there was nothing that was absorbing heat in that way. Lots of trees. A lot of dead trees here, I'm noticing. Wow, the drought is really striking hard. A lot of trees. You drive and you say, oh, there's a dead tree there, it's a dead tree there, it's a dead tree there. Yeah. I'm surprised there are not more dead trees. What are they living on? neither nor, neither nor. I can, I will, I've already done it. I already am. These are the practices that free us from concretization. And don't try to define that word too much. Just practice. It's more important to practice than to try to define. Occasionally, in flipping the script, we might look at it. You know, we look at it, but it's best to stay with the assertions and the wow. That's the most powerful headway. And then, when we can't do it anymore, we might spend time looking at the. But if it's a struggle, then just drop it. If you're trying to clarify, what does it mean? Concretization. What does it mean? We know what it means, really. Nobody's a fool. So this is an example of practicing under stress, under a lot of stress, and still practicing. You know, you get tired, you feel like, oh, my mind is just dropping away. Bring it back, drops away, bring it back, drops away, bring it back. This is what we all struggle with. You know, we're not all some perfect teachers who, you know, it's just flawlessly simple and easy for us. No, it's not. That's not realistic. The continuity fear says, "Oh, sure, you can do that as long as you're really good at it." But no, you can't like struggle. That's not no. We can't have that because it makes continuity fears, you know, as an advisor not seem so great. It's so insecure as an advisor. It allows you to do something if you do it like perfectly right away, and so it can say, "You see, I know you'd be good at it. I'm a great advisor." So if you're not doing it really great, right, you know, you're struggling. Continuity fear says, "Oh, stop. You're not cut out for this. You're not cut out for it, obviously. You know, why don't you do something you're really good at? Like delay. You know, getting sick. Yeah. Let's get sick. We're good at that. That's easy." And it's true. Did you know that sickness is just a habit, bad habits? And we're just really used to it. So we, you know, once you get caught up in that cycle of getting ill and sick, you know, it's amazing what the mind will do. It'll say, "Oh, yeah, let's get sick this way. Let's have this problem." It's extraordinary. Like in baseball, how the amount of injuries have just increased to such an extreme extent compared to just in the 70s. It's ridiculous. 60s to 70s. I mean, what the people back then, like 10 times tougher than we are now? Maybe, but it's their mind. They didn't. They said, "Oh no, there's no injuries in baseball. Really, we don't get injured." And you know, occasionally some of them got sore elbows and arms. It did happen, but by and large, they pitched way more. You know, innings were way more resilient, way less injuries. Now it's just an epidemic of Tommy John elbow surgeries among pitchers. Just an epidemic. it seems like, you know, it seems like the young pitchers, almost like half of them, have had Tommy John surgery, whereas before that, you know, nobody did before that surgery. And, you know, some people blew out their arms, but most of them didn't actually. And then concussions, the whole concussion thing is just extraordinary. I had never heard of a baseball concussion, and neither had baseball people up until recently, really. Never heard of it, never even heard of it happening. Even when they got hit on the head, you know, they experienced, you know, some fear, etc. Maybe, but they came back. They didn't call it the concussion, but anyway, nowadays there's an epidemic of concussions. Oh, I got a concussion. Oh, I got a concussion here. This hit, got hit by the ball. I got a concussion. This is more mental than anything. We're so aware of concussion in sports that everybody, the mind is saying, oh, yeah, concussions. That's what happens to me. I could get a concussion too. Oh, yeah, I want a concussion too. Oh, I have a concussion. So, it's amazing how there's fads in illnesses. Absolutely, there is. If the mind chooses, you know, what it wants, and then it experiences. So, if it wants to be sick, you know, it will be sick. There's so many are, you know, so experts in sickness. Always sick. I got this. Oh, I got this and this. Those are all just defenses against truth, against ending our pretense. We said, I can't end pretending I'm sick. But the sickness too is a pretending. So how can we say, oh, I'm not able to end my pretense because I'm so ill, I'm too ill to do this. When the illness is a pretense too, where is the causation? Where's the logic in that statement? I cannot gently set my pretense down because I'm too sick to do it. I need to be well before I can do that. That's like somebody who's doing an imitation of some celebrity, you know, and then they get kind of like a hoarse throat and they say, well, I can't end the imitation because I'm not doing it good. I got a sore throat. They're imitating, you know, having a sore throat. I can't stop the imitation. Because I'm not doing the right job of imitation or something. I can't stop the imitation. I'm too ill. I have an imitation illness, so I can't stop the imitation. Oh, I can't stop pretending to be such and such because now I'm pretending to be someone else. Yeah, you want me to stop pretending to be such and such, but now I'm pretending to be someone else. No. We wanted to just set all pretending down, not just pretending to be this person or something, you know, all pretense. No, you told me you thought I was pretending to be such and such, and now I'm pretending to be someone else, so this is legitimate. I can't set pretense down. The excuses that we use are quite silly, actually, when we look at them. I can't stop pretending to be sick because I'm too sick. I can't stop pretending to be sick. I'm too sick to do that. Oh, okay. Oh, shoot. I can't stop pretending to be dumb. I'm too dumb to do that. I can't stop pretending to be old. I'm too old for that. I can't stop pretending to be vulnerable. I'm too vulnerable for that. So people get sick to protect their pretense. Oh, I got a cold. I can't. I'd love to drop pretense, but I can't. I got this pretend cold, and that's preventing me from to stop pretending that I have a pretend cold. Really? How does that work? Where's the causation there? Having a hard time seeing genuine logic and causation there, cause and effect. I'm pretending that I'm not pretending, so I cannot stop pretending that I'm not pretending. So practicing is not just smooth and like there's some agenda, plan, a charter, just it goes according to like that. No, we don't know what's going to happen. We're just present with our practicing, and we're just willing for whatever is effective, but let it arise. We're willing to entertain truth and clarity, however it presents itself. So we don't know what the next minute is going to hold. But we won't find out unless we get to it. If we decide, oh, okay, well, I better stop. I don't know how it's going to go now. Well, that's another defense. There's something buried, some stupid little strategy that we'd be helpful to see it. Wow, what a beautiful day. Too bad I can't eat ice cream or anything. Yeah, oh boy. Took September diet. Lost. Trying to hold the line. I do have a goal by the end of September. How many more days do we have? Today's the 25th. So it's 5 more days. 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Five more days. Maybe I can diet for 5 more days. Go into October lean and mean, at least relatively so, with a full head lean and mean with a full head of steam. You want to be lean and mean with a full head of steam going into October. It's very important. October is a month of opportunity for us now, for sure. It's very likely the Holy Spirit is going to make its presence felt and roll out some sort of option for us, great success. Success is going to be present for us. It's very likely that we're going to meet up with success. Maybe once in a lifetime for us. I mean, this is a once in a lifetime thing for many, that they actually meet up with success. It's very rare here, but this is the time when we should expect it. Get our expectations in that direction. We really should expect it. It doesn't matter what our previous beliefs or thoughts, are. When you meet up with success, it's a game changer. It's a real game changer. I've been through it a number of times, actually. Just fundamentally, it's a complete game changer. A Course in Miracles, total game changer. And it just absolutely pivoted my life, and it's never the same. Vastly better. Indescribably better. Real hope entered the situation. Reason, real true reason, true hope. And so, yeah, coming across, success pivots us, and we'll never the same. We'll always be better, way better than we were before. So yeah, this is what we have to look forward to. Everybody, no matter where they're at, this is something that we should look forward to and expect. I can, I will. I already have met up with a pivotal success. Just a gorgeous autumn day, early autumn day. It's like autumn, but it's still, it doesn't feel like winter, you know, at all. I mean, not even close. It just feels like beautiful. Autumn light, LITE. It's very light, lightly, just a taste of it. Other than that, it's perfect. So we might have a faint tinge of the world left, but other than that, it'll be perfect. We'll feel perfect. Everything's just perfect. Meeting up with success, meeting up with success, yeah. This is what we should expect now. Absolutely, embrace it, expect it. I do expect it. Just like came across A Course in Miracles, I expected it. I was looking for something. I know I'm going to find something really important. Something pivotal success. I know I'm going to come across it somehow. And it happened. So we should feel like we know we're going to come across some pivotal success now. We know the game of the President, the Pope, the United Nations, the New World Agenda. We know the game. We don't need to keep examining it like, maybe I'm wrong. No, we know what's going on. False option. Game of false option. To defend continuity fear. Defend pretense. That's all that it is. So, you know, it's all that it is. It's that simple. It's just the common way that we defend, you know, pretense and our, you know, to keep pretending. And we do this on the advice of our continuity fear, saying, oh, no, this is what you should do. This is what's good for you. This is what to make you feel better. That's all that it is. We don't need to go any deeper than that. That is the depth. The full depth is right there. So now we're looking for an option that helps us go towards, you know, setting down our pretending. With, you know, true option. Option of truth, going towards truth. And this is then a, you know, genuine option of success. This is what we're looking for. So we need to start getting in that mood. Is we're really ready to we know what's going to happen, will happen. So we better get ready for that. It's a treat to get ready for it. It's a wonderful way to focus our attention now. Just say, I can come across success. I will come across success. I've already come across the success. I'm already aware of it. I can be aware of it. I will be aware of it. I'm already aware of it. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. So this takes us through three levels, right? It can happen, it will happen, it's already happened. It can happen, it will happen, it's already happened. It can happen, it will happen, it's already happened. So we go up in intensity and then back off. It's sort of a circular thing where we get a little, catch our breath, and we ratchet it up. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. It's like, wow. Then we go back to, it can happen. So there's a little relief from the intensity. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. Just try this. It's an intense practice. And you will feel it's super, super effective. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. It has happened. It has happened. It's already happened. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. So, just try that. Try this out. See how it feels. It can happen. It will happen. It's already happened. All right. So there's a lot of intensity here. And we've gone almost 2 hours. Well, maybe I'll keep going. Why cut it short? Why cut it short? This day, you know, feels like a holy day, a sacred day. The last couple of days and almost every day here, but it feels like a real sacred day. I mean, this is amazing, you know. But we're going for something, you know, much better than that. But maybe in a way, being here in California, it reminds us of paradise, of the death-free realm, and ultimately of reality. Maybe that it's a reminder here, which is maybe why a lot of spiritual efforts have come out of California, for sure. There seems to be this, it's like a faint echo of something. It's just, it's so nice. I feel like there's something I'm missing, you know. There's something within that's even better than this, and I really want that. But this, you know, autumnal solstice like sun, this sort of medium in the sky sun, the angle and everything is so beautiful. It's kind of a gentleness to everything here, a quietness, a gentleness. People don't stop to smell the roses, you know, just notice it. Wow. I will. I've already done it. I can meet up with success. I will meet up success. I've already met up with success. I've already met up with success. I can. I will. I've already done so. I can make it. I will make it. I've already made it. I can get free of concretization. I will get free of concretization. I've already gotten free of concretization. And with that one can come gratitude when you feel it. Allow yourself to feel gratitude as if it were, you were really grateful for what truly has already happened. This gives us a trial run. You see, you get used to a trial run, so when it does happen, surface, we'll be used to it. Say, oh yeah, the gratitude's there, everything's there. Okay, I sort of did this trial runs, and I'm ready for it. So I can be free of concretization. I will be free of concretization. I am already free of concretization. I can do it. I will do it. I've already done it. I can do this. I will do this. I've already done this. I can succeed. I will succeed. I've already succeeded. It'd be nice to just sit here and watch this sunset. It might be a spectacular sunset here. But we're gonna run out of time. It's not on the video, but yeah. I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded. And then I've neither succeeded nor have I not succeeded. So bringing those, both these practices together, I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded, and I've neither succeeded nor not succeeded. Okay? This brings us full circle in our practicing. I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded, and I've neither already succeeded nor not already succeeded. Which enables us to abide by having all the forms of our pretense go quiet, unmoving, like statues. But they feel blessed, elated and blessed, but they're like statues. Still, they go still. I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded. And I've neither succeeded nor have I not succeeded. I've neither succeeded nor have I not succeeded. I've neither succeeded nor have I not succeeded. And every bit of practice we do like this is a huge stride towards abidance. We'll just say abidance. You know, let's just try to keep it as far away from definition as possible, right? Just say abidance. We won't say in what or whatever, just abidance. So, you know, the mind, the fearful mind doesn't fixate too much on anything, just abidance. It leaves it pretty open so we can practice. We don't want to be fixated definition, we want to practice. You see, this is we either fixate or we practice. When we get fixated, definitionally, even though the definitions might be very high spiritual, we don't practice. We say, I don't need to practice. I already got it. I've already fixated. we just abide in. So I can succeed. I will succeed. I've already succeeded. I've neither succeeded nor have I not succeeded. This takes us huge strides towards abidance. So we must keep our efforts going full blast right now. So keep practicing. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded. Keep this going, keep this going, keep this going. Full blast in October. Hit the ground running, lean and mean, and ready for success in October. Ready for success. And so full head of steam. We're not getting caught up in any concepts here. We're practicing. We're not getting fixated on anything. We're practicing. This is what we want to hit the ground running in October as great practitioners, you know, ready for success, ready to meet up with success. And that is what we will do. This is our aim. So I have to attend, help someone out here, and I will. So Need not rush off too quickly here. Let not the world dictate to us what our agenda is here. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can meet up with success. I will meet with success. I've already met with success. I can pivot my life. I will pivot my life. I've already pivoted my life. So hang in there. 5 more days to September. Keep practicing. Keep doing, and then this will help you keep going. Say, hey, I can do this. I really can. I can, I will. I've already done it. I can, I will. I've already done it. And I've neither done it nor not done it. I've neither succeeded nor not succeeded. Just keep trying, keep practicing like this, and again, you will be vastly farther along towards freedom from concretization, towards abidance, just by practicing this, getting used to it. You don't have to intellectualize it or conceptualize it or fixate. Just practice, and you'll feel a wow within you. See, this is how you get past fixation. You feel the wow within you. There's something responding to this within us. It's not our intellect either, is it? It's not. It's our spirit that's responding. And so we say, wow, there's something beyond my intellect that gets this, that's wiser than my intellect. Of course there is. Of course there is. Again. One moment. So the world keeps whirling along. See, its agenda, humanistic agenda, keeps going along, and will sweep us along if we don't meet up with pivotal success here. So I can meet up with pivotal success. I will meet up with pivotal success. I have already met up with pivotal success. Wow. And just full stop in the wild. Don't let the intellect get engaged or the emotions, that continuity, belief system, personality complex. Don't let it get engaged. There's something else that you're engaging with that is way more profound. Let that engagement, the wow, be there. Okay, this is the key. So lean and mean, ready for success in October. All right. Be in good shape going into October. Just power through, right towards it. Okay, well, just power into it. Very great. Okay, now that's it, and I'm going to have to do a few things.